Hey, good morning, everybody. I'm Love Coach Scott Catamas, and this is the Sacred Sunday Show. And I want to welcome everybody watching, and I want to acknowledge that the majority of you watch the replay. So we always appreciate those of you that are live. Welcome to Nancy and Jay and James and Grant and everybody in the Zoom room. And a big hello to people out in Facebook land. And we've got a really great, great guest today. You know, what I've done with this show is I take some of the most interesting people that I meet on Saturday Night Live and invite them to be on the Sacred Sunday Show so we can really go deeper and have a longer conversation. And I want to acknowledge the lovely Jan Kaplan, who's with us also. Jan is who created the connection with John Kay. And John is our special guest. And so I'm gonna go to gallery view so you can see both Jan, of course, is with Jay, and there's John and Jay, but this is actually with John Kay. And if I had prepared properly, I could have done a really good rhyme with all of that. Hey, welcome, John, and welcome, Jan.
Good morning.
Good to have you both. And we're gonna really be getting a chance to know John. I gotta say, as a teenager, I was so into the band Steppenwolf. And the Monster album was like my favorite album of all time. And I've just been, it's so remarkable that teenage Scott never would have imagined that Scott in his 60s would be hanging out with John Kay and having a chance to talk to him. So that's pretty cool. And what we're really gonna talk about is John's transformation, the fascinating life he's had, and why he and his wife became wildlife advocates, what that really means. And really, a life well lived. As I watched his documentary, as I've gotten to know John, John, you've lived a good life. And you've made really beautiful choices, and you've busted some myths. He's been married for over three decades to the same woman. Happily married, and they do great work together. And that's a really beautiful thing, you know, from the wild, crazy, born to be wild rocker to a man who's, you know, very happy in his domesticity with grandchildren and really dedicated to make the world a better place in the way that you have. So we're going to talk about that. As people who watch the show on a regular basis know, I always like to start us off just with a brief little meditation first to drop in. So I want to invite everybody to put away your other devices, stop multitasking if that's what's going on, and let's just breathe together for a minute or two. Just slowing everything down. Let my voice gently guide you. And as we drop in, just to notice our breath, breathing at your own pace, and remembering how blessed we are to have breath, to have life. Two nights ago, we did a memorial service for one of our friends who passed away suddenly last week. Such a reminder that every breath, every day of life is a blessing. So I invite us all in our own way to take a moment of gratitude, grateful for our breath, grateful for our life, grateful for the opportunity to spend a little time together and to learn from John about his life, his choices. It's nice to slow down and drop in. Thank you, everybody. And I will be periodically checking the questions that come in, both in the Zoom room and on Facebook. And so when you see me, I'm going to put the spotlight on John for most of the time. But if you see me looking down, it's because I'm checking to see what questions might be there. And I'm going to start by just showing a very brief, the first couple of minutes of this wonderful documentary, and I'll put the link to the documentary. It's called Born to be Wild, and it's all about John. And so we're gonna show just the first few minutes of it, and then I'm gonna drop into direct conversation with John. So here we go, I'm gonna pull that up for us. Make sure I optimize the sound, and here we go.
Hello. They say that everyone has a story to tell. Well, this is my story, that of the band Steppenwolf, and finally my journey of becoming a wildlife advocate. I hope you find it engaging and enjoyable. Now let's get started. So, how did that guy become this guy? Well, to answer that question, I have to first tell you how this little fellow with the dark glasses became a rock and roller to begin with, because that's me, 4 years old and living in communist East Germany, in the idea that someday I would be in America playing music. Well, that was unimaginable. I was born during World War II in East Prussia, which was part of Germany at the time. My parents lived in the town of Tilsit until my father, who was in the German army, was killed in Russia about a month before I was born. With the Russian army about to overrun East Prussia, my mother took me in her arms and got on a train heading west. The train stopped in the town of Arnstadt, because the tracks ahead had been bombed. When my mother got off the train, she met a kind woman whose family gave us shelter in a room above their tannery. When the war ended in 1945, the Russian army marched in and erected a border dividing Germany into communist East Germany and American-occupied West Germany, and we were now trapped behind the so-called Iron Curtain. My mother soon noticed my poor eyesight, and a doctor told her that my vision might improve if I had a better diet. At the time, we were on food rations of primarily fish, usually herring. Herring cooked, boiled, fried, pickled. I did not touch fish again until I was in my 30s. But because West Germany not only held the promise of a better diet, but also freedom, my mother decided we would try to escape, a dangerous undertaking that could result in being shot or imprisoned. But, like the people in this film clip, we were lucky and made it safely to the other side and wound up in the town of Hanover, which at the end of the war looked like this. At first, we lived in a small attic room while my mother went to work as a seamstress. Some months later, she married a good man who had survived 5 years in a Russian prisoner of war camp, for she felt that a boy needs a father. We were now a family and qualified to move into a small newly built apartment. Ours was the one at the top right. Soon I turned 6 and had to go to school. It was customary to distract the young victim from thinking about this alarming development with a cone full of candy. Well, it didn't work. I was miserable in public school. Schools were still being rebuilt and were vastly overcrowded with 2 shifts of students a day. I couldn't read the blackboard, and I didn't do well. My mother, who continued to work, was determined that I receive a good education, and somehow managed to get me into the private Waldorf school. The school was banned by the Nazis because its teachings were far too enlightened to suit them, but it had reopened after the war, and I was happy there, for the teachers looked after me. When I was 12, I came across the Armed Forces radio network and heard this coming out of the speaker.
Gonna tell Aunt Mary about Uncle John. He claimed he has the misery, but he's having a lot of fun. Oh, baby. Yes, baby. Woo, baby. Having me some fun tonight. Yeah.
Well, what was that? I had chicken skin from head to toe when I heard Little Richard, and later Elvis, Chuck Berry, and others. I became obsessed with rock and roll and fantasized that someday I would be on the other side of the ocean and play this music. That's me, age 13, with my first girlfriend. I dressed like the older rockers I hung out with, and I digged those two-tone shoes. Not long after my rock and roll baptism, we received good reports from family members in Canada, and my parents decided we would emigrate as well. So in March 1958, we were joined by friends and neighbors for a farewell photo at the airport, and then we were off to Toronto, Canada. After three flights, with a refueling stop in Ireland, we arrived 36 hours later in our new hometown and moved into the top floor of this house. Well, I didn't know anybody there, and I didn't speak English yet, so our radio became my new best friend. I listened not only to rock and roll, but also country music, rhythm and blues, and on Sunday mornings, stirring gospel music from the black churches in Buffalo. If it moved me, I didn't care what kind of music it was. Because of my limited vision and my lack of English, it was decided that I would attend so-called sight-saving classes, operated by the CNIB, the Canadian National Institute for the Blind. The CNIB also loaned me a tape recorder, just like this one, so I could listen to talking books. But by that time, I had gotten my first guitar, and I immediately recorded my playing and singing on this machine. Well, I was appalled by what I heard. That can't be my voice. I really sound this bad? I was highly, highly disappointed. But I was determined to improve, and I just kept at it. Later, after learning English, I attended this regular high school. But it was not a good fit. Much too regimented and boring. The one bright spot during this uninspiring period was music, particularly when we, underage delinquents, managed to see this band play, Ronnie Hawkins and the Hawks. These guys were smoking and showed us what a truly great band sounds like. Some years later, after working with Bob Dylan, they, minus Ronnie Hawkins, renamed themselves simply The Band, and wrote and recorded some of the best music of the 60s and 70s. After finishing high school in 1963, I joined my parents who had moved to Buffalo, New York. At this time, folk music was going through a major revival, and there were coffee houses and folk clubs all across the country, and I started to perform in coffee houses as well. However, if you wanted to see the best of the traditional and new artist, you went to the Newport Folk Festival in Rhode Island, which I attended in 1964 and 5. That's where I saw Delta Blues legend Son House and Bob Dylan when he went electric, and many other greats. Experiencing this with thousands of young people was a galvanizing experience that stayed with you. When you went home, you knew you were not alone. After attending the festival in 64, a friend invited me to join him on a road trip to California. When I returned, I said, "I'm moving to California. I like the weather there, the beaches, the palms, the girls. I'm going." My mother replied, "While you were gone, we spoke to your aunt in Santa Monica, and she also really likes it there, so we've decided to move to California." After 4 days of driving, we arrived in Santa Monica, and I started looking around for folk clubs and found the Troubadour in West Hollywood. I was hanging out at the Troubadour so much that Doug Weston, the owner, gave me a job. Dishwashing, work in the ticket booth, whatever, and I got to listen to the pros. particularly this man, Hoyt Axton. I liked his singing and songs. It was from him that I learned The Pusher, an anti-hard drug song which Steppenwolf would play for decades. Despite making some good friends in L.A., by the spring of 65, I felt I was just treading water, so I took my guitar and hitchhiked back to the East Coast, eventually winding up in Toronto again. In the Yorkville Village area, things had really exploded while I was gone. There were now lots of clubs with all kinds of live music. It was a really happening scene. I was playing at a coffee house there, not that one, when I met the Sparrows, a local band that was doing quite well. After sitting in with the guys a couple of times, we decided to join forces, and I became a member of the Sparrows. The kids seemed to like our sound, and we soon had the place jumping. One night, our bass player Nick said, "My girlfriend is here, and she brought her girlfriend. Why don't you join us at their table over there?" That's when I met this young woman named Jutta Mauer. She was from Hamburg, Germany, really liked music, had seen the Beatles and others at the Star Club there, and left on her own at age 18 for Canada. Well, a man's got to know what he wants, and I wanted to know her better. So I followed her home that night and moved in with her. That was October 65. We've been partners ever since. A couple of days later, I went to get my stuff from another girl's place where I'd been staying, and there was a guy there playing guitar. I asked who he was, and he said, "My name is Neil Young. I'm from Winnipeg, and I've just joined the Minor Birds." Now, the Minor Birds were another Toronto band that had Rick James as its lead singer. Years later, Rick had a big hit called Super Freak. Neil Young and Rick James in the same band? Well, it was the 60s, and anything seemed possible. At that time, many Canadian acts went to the U.S. to make their mark because Canada was still a relatively small market for record sales. So, in the summer of 66, after signing a deal with Columbia Records, we migrated to New York and moved into the infamous Hotel Albert, which was usually full of musicians and other undesirables. We first played a jet set club named Arthur's, and then the downtown club in the Village, where we alternated with the Chambers Brothers and where Bette Midler was in charge of the coat check room. After cutting a couple of tracks for Columbia, the label released this single, which sounded nothing like the blues and rock we played live and went nowhere. I had been pestering the guys about trying our luck in Los Angeles, where I had seen the formation of the Birds. And so, in the early fall of 1966, we left over $1,000 of parking tickets behind and drove to L.A. to play a club on the Sunset Strip called It's Boss, which previously was called Ciro's and later became the Comedy Store. After that, we played the Whiskey A Go-Go, alternating with the Sir Douglas Quintet, which had a hit called She's About a Mover. Things were going fairly well for us until a major altercation broke out between kids at a teen club on the Strip named Pandora's Box and the LAPD. Hundreds of kids would come from all over to hang out, and things got out of hand. Steve Stills wrote For What It's Worth about these confrontations. Some bottom feeders in Hollywood couldn't resist making a cheesy B-picture about all this. Unfortunately, because of the so-called riots, the clubs on the Strip changed their booking policy, and we were out of work. We had heard good things about the scene in San Francisco, so we hitched our U-Haul trailer to the band's station wagon and headed to the city by the bay and Haight-Ashbury. We soon started playing the Avalon Ballroom, sometimes with the Doors or Country Joe and the Fish, Quicksilver Messenger Service, Charlie Musselwhite, and others. We also played at the Ark, a beached ferry boat in Sausalito. Hell's Angels would come by, drop some LSD, lie on the dance floor, and listen to us jam. I believe I mentioned we played the Avalon with the Doors. Well, despite playing some good gigs and the exciting pre-Summer of Love scene in San Francisco, by the spring of 67, the clubs in L.A. were booking rock bands again, and Columbia Records had released us from our contract. We knew that the recording industry on the West Coast was in Los Angeles, so we decided to give L.A. another try. We returned to play a week-long engagement at the Galaxy Club, a couple of doors up from the Whiskey. You can see the Galaxy on the right side there. Well, that turned out to be the last gig the Sparrows ever played. After a major shouting match between the club owner and our drummer Jerry, we were fired and the band broke up. Well, now what? My girlfriend Jutta had arrived earlier from Toronto, and as per strict instructions from the Immigration and Naturalization Service, we had to get married within 10 days of her arrival. In order for her to get her visa, I had signed an affidavit that we planned to get married. So we went down to the LA courthouse, paid our $5. I'd forgotten the wedding ring I had borrowed, so we got a plastic ring out of a bubblegum machine, I kid you not, and we were married. None of that destination wedding stuff for us. And then we moved into this little apartment above a garage. Because the Sparrow was no more and I was unemployed, Jutta got a job as a cocktail waitress at the Pink Pussycat, a strip club on Santa Monica Boulevard. Some weeks later, a girlfriend of Jutta's, also from Toronto, moved in next door with her new husband, a record producer by the name of Gabriel Mickler. After hearing some live Sparrow recordings, Gabriel suggested I form a new band. I called ex-Sparrows drummer Jerry Edmonton and organist Goldie McJohn and Michael Monarch, a 17-year-old guitar player who had jammed with us at the Galaxy Club. All three were on board. We now just needed a bass player. We posted a bass player wanted note on the bulletin board of a record store, and a fellow named Rushton showed up. He plugged in, played great, and got the gig. We then set up what gear wasn't in the Hawk Shop in the garage below the tiny apartment Jutta and I lived in and started to rehearse. The police came by a couple of times because of noise complaints, but we kept at it until Gabriel said we were ready to cut some demos, which he then brought to Dunhill Records. A few days later, Gabriel and I met with Jay Lasker, Dunhill's president. That's Jay on the left, who said, "John, your demos? I'm not sure I get it, but my daughter likes them and she might have better ears, so we're going to take a chance with you guys." We had no manager, nor money for a lawyer, so we pretty well signed what he put in front of us. Gabriel had read the book Steppenwolf by Hermann Hesse and suggested we call our band the same. We hadn't come up with a better idea, so Steppenwolf it would be. This is Gabriel's painting of the birthplace of the band Steppenwolf. That painting of the garage now hangs in our garage at our home. We soon found ourselves in the studio of the American Recording Company that Richard Podler, that's him in the foreground, and his partner Bill Cooper had built. Both were excellent recording engineers, and we were ready. After 4 days, we walked out of that studio with a finished album that included Born to Be Wild and The Pusher and cost $9,000 to make. It still sounds pretty good today, my biased opinion notwithstanding.
I think at this point it's good to bring John on because I think we know what happened after that. But I mean, we'd have learned a lot in talking to you directly. But John, what an amazing life you've led.
Well, some of us are blessed with having more luck than sense or talent. And, you know, Jutta played a huge role in all of this once the two of us became partners. And, you know, we were certainly blessed with the proverbial being at the right place at the right time. Because, for instance, getting that record deal, Why were they willing to take a chance? A couple of reasons. One was that the British invasion with the Beatles and everything else had thrown the kind of traditional record industry for a loop. A bunch of young kids writing their own songs. My God, what do we do now? We're not used to that sort of thing. Okay, sign anything with long hair and let's hope we get lucky. You know, so we had a little bit of that going on. You know, Paul Simon's song, Born at the Right Time, comes to mind. Jutta is an excellent example of that. Her older sister, 6 years older than her, missed the 60s, had none of the, you know, all the stuff that you and I lived through. Her younger sister, 6 years younger than Jutta, missed the boat as well. So being, you know, born at a certain point where you then as a teenager get into the 60s and the counterculture and all of that, it plays a huge role. And the one aspect that stayed with me because of my youth, having been born in a country that was responsible because of the Nazis having killed millions of people, whether in death camps or overrunning their countries like Poland and whatever, we grew up with an imperative lesson. Never forget what happened here. And be on the lookout. You know, there's a rebuilt Checkpoint Charlie Museum in Berlin, on the outside of which in English and German, it says something like this, and I'm paraphrasing. It says, visitor, learn from what happened here. Go home, be ever vigilant, and look out for the ugly face of fascism to rise again. And so Jutta and I carried that with us in terms of being aware. And you alluded to the Monster album early, and the roots of much of what was written lyrically on that album. Well, those roots go all the way back to my upbringing in West Germany. You know,
I was just checking in on Facebook. You're absolutely right. I missed the draft, the Vietnam draft, by 6 months. I had a lot of older friends who didn't miss the draft, and some of them went to Vietnam and some of them didn't come back. And I did notice, you know, as I watched that, there were some really key moments where there was the good fortune, the very fact that you guys made it out of East Germany into West Germany, the fact that the record producer's daughter liked your music, you know,
right.
Right. I mean, something that simple that she just, I mean, she might have just said, oh, yeah, I like it. They're good, Dad. I mean, something that simple makes this gigantic difference in your life. Right.
It's so true. And there are dozens, as there are, I think, in everyone's life. If you look over your shoulder and you kind of see where you've been, there are usually dozens of key little moments where, you know, the fork in the road you chose to take the, you know what I mean? So you have to, yeah. By the way, the draft, you know, I was born, you know, what they now tell me is being legally blind. Well, it kept me from Vietnam. Because as George Carlin once said, one of the oxymorons is military intelligence. And yes. When I came to Buffalo, the first letter and only letter that I ever got was from the draft board. So I showed up. And at this point, I'm working in a candle factory of the Buffalo Association for the Blind. And I'm telling this guy at the draft thing, saying, you know, I'm legally, and says, son, we'll get to that. So after an hour and a half of a total physical, top to bottom, he says, now read the chart on the wall. And I said, what chart? And he looked at me kind of puzzled. And I go, well, you know, I'm legally blind. And he was about to say, you could have told me, but he caught himself short. And I said, well, what's going to happen? He says, well, you will be classified as 4F. And I said, well, what does that mean? He said, well, son, basically it means we'll take women and children first, not you. You know, wow. So I was given a free pass, but I knew people my age who wound up in Vietnam, you know, so.
So, there was the choices that there were good fortune. But John, there's another choice that I want to talk to you about, and that is that you're with this amazing woman that you had to use a plastic ring from out of a bubblegum machine. You know, the exact opposite of everything that you see in the movies. And I just want to talk to you for a moment about how have you managed, my gosh, 50 years, right? 51 years, is it?
Correct. Yeah. Well, so, a lot of the credit really goes to Jutta, because she, a couple of girlfriends asked her one time, what's the secret to your long marriage? And she said, not getting a divorce. you know, and because there were so many things she had to contend with, you know, shortly after. I mean, our daughter Sean was born in March 1968. And while she was born, you know, while Jutta was going through labor, I was on stage for Bill Graham in San Francisco, Steppenwolf playing with one of my favorite groups, Staple Singers. And, you know, so that's how crazy things were. All of a sudden, we caught Steppenwolf caught a wave of success, and we were going nonstop, meaning, you know, writing songs, rehearsing songs, recording songs, you know, all the rest of it, television shows, on and on and on. And so Jutta had to kind of swallow hard a few times, because it was gone so much, and here's a baby to be raised, and you know, we're a couple of kids who really, you know, I remember we had management who said, well, you know, you ought to buy a house, and Jutta and I are going, looking at each other, is he kidding? Buy a house? We're raised in West Germany, where they, you know, at a time where credit cards didn't exist, you saved up your cash to buy a good winter coat. The idea of buying a house on credit was so alien that, you know, so the point being, we had lots of stuff to learn, how to just negotiate this path we were on with all the various obligations to the band, to you know, our young daughter, to our relationship, our career, and et cetera, et cetera. So Steppenwolf had its ups and downs. It was never all just roses and rainbows. Jutta and I sure as heck had our disagreements along the way. But then certain things happened in her life that gave her her own sense of self-worth and capabilities. And that was when she discovered karate, which she diligently practiced at a dojo 5 nights a week for 13 years straight to get her black belt. And she and I would work out at a club and all of that. So around age 30, we decided to make some lifestyle changes. There was a whole lot less drinking. You know, the drugs were sort of put on hold. We started doing very boring things like getting sleep and eating properly and working out regularly. And now at age 77, those decisions have played enormous dividends, you know. And then, of course, much later came our exposure to and gradual transformation into what the last 15 years has really been our driving wheel, and that is conservation and wildlife protection and those things. But I should quit yakking and let you ask the questions you would like to voice.
Well, you're doing great. And I'm going to share just a couple of photos so people can see that you are with Jutta. Now, obviously, yeah, those are more recent, a more recent photo. I'm going to show one more.
That's proof, yeah.
And you know, what a beautiful couple, you know, and what an incredible love story. And we are going to talk about the wildlife advocacy, but it is also, to me, John, equally remarkable to have had a 5-decade marriage and partnership, and especially given the world that you were in, with a lot of drugs and alcohol. And interesting, I'm actually in a production studio. Last night we did a whole show working with the people that get Gabor Mate's work out in the world. Our whole show is about dealing with drugs and addiction. And so just for a moment, I want to ask you, was there a turning point for you? Was there maybe someone that you had been close to in the industry and you watched how their life went to hell, or maybe even a death that was a turning point for you?
Well, not quite that, but I should mention the following. Whereas some people, you know, other musicians and creative people that we knew, like the rest of society, you know, where people have drinking issues or whatever, there were those who, from my perspective, were overdoing it with respect to what they were consuming. I had this sense of responsibility because I was the founder and leader of the band, and I felt an obligation not only to my own family, but also what now were families of band members, even crew members. And so I kind of did the model of the guy who comes home from work at 5:30 and has his evening martini, right? Except in my case, all right, it's now evening time. We're going to go over to the Troubadour to hang out at the bar. Let's smoke a joint. In other words, I did those things when I felt I had done my daily duty, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, there were those, as I mentioned, and we all know. I mean, I remember being in the Avalon ballroom dressing room when we were still, might have been still the Sparrows, might have already been Steppenwolf. And, you know, Janice would come by just to hang out, and she had her bottle of Southern Comfort, you know. And I don't know whether that was just the need to be as you know, like the blues mamas, like, you know, that she was inspired by. I knew Jimi Hendrix not very well, but spent some time with him, you know, one time. And never really knew Jim Morrison. But you know, when all three of these people lost their lives for various reasons, yes, of course, that was an enormous reminder of how when you don't put on the brakes, you can run off the edge of the cliff. And there were many, many others. I mean, Lowell George, who was an astounding talent, you know, with Little Feet. Al Wilson with Canned Heat. And, you know, there's probably a dozen more I could name if I took the time to remember them. But, you know, to remember the names and circumstances. But yes, they were all victims of falling prey to, you know, and then, of course, you have many of the great jazz people who had various addictions, you know. So it's a demon that you have to learn how to control, and everybody has a different psychological profile, and sometimes the demon gets you, you know, instead of you keeping it in the cage.
You know, because I was a big fan of your band, and your song The Pusher, the depth, and I encourage people, go back and listen to it. There's so much anger. I'm getting chills remembering my experience of how you sang that song and the absolute anger that came out in your voice towards the pusher man, and the way you presented it always made a big impression on me. And honestly, I was lucky. I mean, I grew up, I was blessed. I enjoyed psychedelics, and I never got into the hard stuff. I never got into bad stuff. And honestly, I got to say, probably your adamant voice about the pusher probably was one of the influences, like, hey, don't go too far. I'm curious, when you recorded that, was there a particular inspiration? Now, you mentioned earlier, of course, Hoyt Axton, and you kind of picked up the song from him. But there was something in there, man, that a lot came out in your voice in that song. And I'm just curious about that.
Yeah, well, you touched upon something no one has ever addressed. You know, and as you can imagine, over 50 years of doing what I've been doing, lots of interviews. And not all of them, you know, many of them are kind of scratching your head. But in any case, you raised a very good point, because Hoyt's performance of the song live at the Troubadour, and Hoyt at that time was doing very well in LA. He played the Troubadour for a week at a time, almost every 3 months. And so I heard that performance of that song numerous times. And what I shared so very much was his anger towards the pusher, because whereas I too later down the line, you know, yeah, you know, there was psychedelics and I was fine with those, meaning I, you know, they were eye openers in many ways. Even let's call it Peruvian marching powder. That stuff can really do a number on your, you know, personality. What was it, Carlin or something said, the trouble with blow, or something, he said, yeah, you know, my friend said, that stuff will make a new man out of you. Well, maybe so, but the problem is the new man wants another hit, you know? So, right. Yeah. So, but yeah, I never stuck a needle in my arm, and I always felt that doing that for non-medicinal purposes, you know, like vaccinations, whatever, was sort of, you know, I don't want to go into the body as a temple, but the idea of doing that to your body, to doing that to yourself, was really repugnant to me. And I felt that a pusher, particularly those who deliberately got people hooked in order to have a greater clientele, I felt that these people were really despicable. And so my anger was very much directed to the pusher of, you know, hard, heavily addictive drugs. Yeah, you caught that very well. Now, you know, I remember somebody saying, well, now, Magic Carpet Ride, the lyrics, are they about drugs? And I said, listen, when Steppenwolf wanted to sing about drugs, there was no camouflaging, you know. We had a song called Don't Step on the Grass, Sam, which was, by the way, Spiro Agnew's favorite song, you know, where you knew exactly where we stood, in this case, on, you know, with respect to marijuana. But yeah, the pusher was a way of Hoyt getting his anger out. And I basically picked it up from there and ran with it.
Well, you did an amazing job. We got a couple questions from our audience that are really good. Grant asked, did John's Waldorf schooling influence your career path by the encouragement of soulful creativity? Good question, Grant.
This is a very good question. I have to say my neurons are being stimulated by your and as well as Grant's question. What I found liberating about the Waldorf School, you know, and for those who don't know, the Waldorf School is an anomaly in terms of traditional German education, because it was actually Rudolf Steiner was the man who wrote this whole thesis that was incorporated into how the Waldorf School goes about teaching. Well, this came to pass way back in, God, it might have been 1890 or 1915 or something. The owner of the Waldorf Astoria tobacco plants had come across Rudolf Steiner's writings or something and hired him, or Steiner, to create a school for the children of the employees of the tobacco plants, which at that time, the idea of doing that, it was just, you know, I mean, talk about progressive. Well, in any case, by the time I went to the Waldorf School, there were, I think, like 25 Waldorf schools in the world, and now there's over 50, whatever. And what suited me about that school was I had just come out of this government elementary school, which was overburdened because of the post-war situation. And here I was in the hands of teachers that knew you and stay. Our main class teacher would stay with the same set of students through multiple grades and watched you develop as a small human being. The first 2 hours of every day in that school was with the same teacher. So 3 years down the line, he had seen you develop and everything. But overall, the Waldorf school had a very humanitarian view of, well, humanity and the world we live in. And I mean, we learned about Zoroastrianism. We learned about Greek and, you know, all this other stuff, which was a broad, very broad, you know, basically a, we are humans and how did we get to where we are? Where did we come from? And, you know, who along the path of to where we are is something worth knowing about and learning about. And it was the very, you know, antithesis of what the government schools were, which is, here's the book. These are the names of the battles you need to remember. And the war started in 18, you know, and all of that. And when I came into Canada and went to the Humberside Collegiate, I had another serving of that same kind of regimented, you know. So yes, the Waldorf School gave me freedom of pursuing my own thoughts and interests. And it was so different from other schools. Girls and boys together in gym class, boys and girls together with their own vegetable garden, boys and girls together, boys learning how to knit, girls learning how to do woodwork. You know, it was a whole different way of teaching. And yes, it definitely caused me to have a greater desire to, you know, there wasn't the constraints. There wasn't this sort of being, stay inside of this box because the world of industry needs somebody with your diploma when you are done. You know, it was more learn. The Germans have a word called Allgemeinbildung, which means your overall education, which is not necessarily derived from schools, but that you can be a well-informed, functional human being in a broad society. And, you know, rather than being constricted to, well, you know, your grades are insufficient, I think a plumber is what you want to be. You know, that that kind of thing.
Yeah. Jan had a good question. She wanted to know if your mother lived long enough to see your success and how that was for her, given what she went through, the incredible upbringing she gave you despite all those challenges. Tell us about your relationship with your mother and how it was for her to watch her son grow up to be a rock star.
Right. Well, thank you, Jan, for that question, because my mother taught me many things. But my just observing her, the love of her life had been taken from her just you know, a couple of weeks before I was born. And so now you have to leave the only place you've ever known. And you are now a war widow. And because of that, the Nazis give you permission with a little pass to leave your home, because the Nazis knew the Russians were going to overrun East Prussia. And the last thing they wanted was a panicking population rushing for, you know, to escape. So that was the trick through which she managed to get out early, rather than the other ones in East Prussia that threw everything they own in a wagon, put a horse there and try to get out. So we wind up in Arnstadt, which became part of communist East Germany. And there she had to tell me, when I was old enough to ask her, where's my father? And she had to tell me, well, he, you know, I'm a very, very young boy, 3.5, 4 years old. And he said, he's up there. With the stars. He's up there with the stars. And he sees you. But that experience is the arch pain that I still have in me to this day. But I saw from her conduct, her courage. Life has thrown stuff at me, and I will not capitulate to the dark side. I will not let it rob me of the joy of living. And so I was, in essence, raised by her and her attitude towards life. She had a great sense of humor. Even though I learned to greatly respect my stepfather when I was mature enough to recognize that he was a good man, I did not initially accept him as my, quote, father, because my mother had told me a lot of things about my real father. And so in my mind, no one would be able to replace him. I have here on my hand my mother's ring and my father's ring, which was sent by a fellow soldier that he took off my father's body and sent back to us. When she, my mother, decided to risk imprisonment and escape from communist East Germany, I then saw her in West Germany, becoming a well-respected tailor seamstress that took on private clients, customers, and continued to work not only in West Germany, later in Canada, until she retired. And so to answer your actual question with an extremely long-winded introduction, was that, yes, she was still living in Los Angeles after Steppenwolf was formed. At the very beginning, when Jutta and I moved into that little apartment, money was in short supply. So my mother went on occasion visit to see her grandchild and slip me $20 or whatever. And then eventually Steppenwolf, caught a wave of success. And one of my greatest pleasures was to invite her to be a special guest in the VIP section of the first time when we played the Anaheim Convention Center, which was sold out. And she saw her boy up there being cheered by thousands of people. And, your father would be proud, she thought. And she said, well, he never was a professional musician, but he played a little bit of violin, he played a little accordion. So maybe you got some of that from him. But in a nutshell, she had a her raising me was sort of vindicated to some degree through my success.
So, John, I, as a coach, always like to ask people when I see tears, even if they're tears that are stuffed, those tears always have something precious to say. And when you were recounting being that little boy, and your mother telling you your father's up in the stars, and you looked up, I saw those tears that were close to the surface.
Oh, yeah.
And if you don't mind, I want to ask you what those tears have to say.
Well, to some extent, my inquiry with my mother as to where my father is was triggered by a playmate in the streets of Arnstadt. I don't know, we got into a little bit of a, disagreement about something. And he said something that was not kind. And then he said something, so you don't have a father. Mm. And so that kind of triggered, because the gentleman who owned the tannery where my mother and I were given shelter, refuge. He kind of adopted me in the sense of being a male figure in my life, a very kind man. You know, he, come on, Kip, you know, you can hang out and see how we make leather and, you know, all this stuff. And so there was a male presence in my life. And I guess I just took whatever reality I was living in that early, you know, that's the only one you know, of course. And it wasn't until this kid raised the issue of me not having a father that I went to my mother to ask about that. And I found I had a, you know, pangs of profound loss when she explained that to me. My ability to empathize with others, which I often do, you know, particularly children, you know, whatever, the refugees and all that, is rooted in my ability to relate because of my own very early youthful experience in that regard.
Yeah, it's beautiful. When you look up to the stars at age 77, do you still see your dad?
Well, not directly. I only have a handful of photos and the ring. I wrote a song, a very ballady kind of song that I recorded on an album called All in Good Time many years ago now. And the lyrics go, I often lie awake at night and gaze into the sky. And often lie awake and I gaze into the sky. It has something to do with how, and wonder, you know, and I wonder at, you know, what I see as the stars go drifting by. And every time I wonder at the beauty of the view, and when its magic touches me, that's when I, pardon me, that's when I think of you.
Beautiful.
That's a really beautiful moment you're sharing with us, John.
Mm-hmm. I'm surprised by my inability to suppress, but there's something, Yoda said one time, well, there's a great book, by the way, by a female psychiatrist called Maybe You Should Talk to Somebody. And I read it, and it's quite a wonderful read, you know. And Yoda said, well, maybe you should talk to somebody. And said, yeah, maybe I will. But, you know, I guard this ability, or rather this deeply seated stuff that comes out at times, because I kind of treat it as a precious thing that confirms my deeper humanity. And it's not that I'm saying I wouldn't be happy if I was able to kind of say, that's nobody's business. I can talk my way through this without, you know, having this emotional response. But by the same token, that's among other things who I am, you know, who makes me who I am. So I'm not, I don't feel awkward about it, because it just, to me, confirms that there is something inside that, you know, I kind of value.
I just got to say, it's interesting how when tears come, I was very close to my father, and he passed away when I was 22. And then my wife passed away. She was also German, 9 years ago. And I wear two rings, this ring representing my father, it was his, and this ring representing my wife. And there is something about how we carry them with us. When my father died, I didn't cry. I was 22, you know. Years went by. And it wasn't until I went back to Dodger Stadium, the baseball stadium that Dad and I used to go to. And I stopped going to baseball games when he died, because that's what we did. And finally, my best buddy took me to the ball game. And the moment I saw the stadium, I lost it. And I remember my friend had to pull over, and I went into the back seat of the car because I was just weeping so hard, right? Years later. So it's interesting how, you know, we cry when we're ready to cry. The emotions come when they're ready to come. But those precious relationships, our father, our mother, our beloveds, they do live forever with us. And there is a connection that our little pea brains can't possibly comprehend, right?
I agree with you wholeheartedly because, you know, many, Jutta told me one time that when her grandfather, who she, actually her grandmother, whom she really was very fond of, when she, when the grandmother died and the family gathered for the funeral, Jutta did not weep. And she felt a little strange about that. But quite some time later, at a seemingly unrelated occurrence that had some, you know, relationship to her knowing her grandmother, all of a sudden it burst forth. And, you know, this happens so often where either willingly something is being suppressed or you know, you're in the where it comes out at unexpected times and situations, but it confirms that it's in there, you know, and it's just, yeah, we one of the things about being 77 is that you now have lived long enough to know how little you really know.
Isn't that the truth? When we're teenagers, we know everything.
Yes.
And the older we get, the more we realize how little we know. That's absolutely true.
One of my great regrets, sorry to step on you for a moment, but one of my great regrets about the 60s is the lost opportunity of two generations joining together like gigantic draft horses and pulling the wagon of humanity, you know, forward. Because, you know, it was the typical thing of, you old guys, you screwed up everything. We have to clean up your mess. And they're going, you ingrates. You have no idea what it was like to go through the, you know, the depression and the and living hand to mouth and walking to school barefoot in the snow for 3 miles uphill both ways. And, you know, all that kind of stuff, which was like this headbutting. Instead of, you know, I remember distinctly one time a young guy, this was in San Francisco, we were playing, saying that, you know, he's from basically suburbia, you know, middle class, and, oh, I don't need a Cadillac and all, you know, and I get his point of view. And then I talked to an older Black person who is in the Fillmore district where the Fillmore Ballroom was, and he's offended by that remark because he says, all my life, I've worked hard to get a Cadillac because when I have one, I am somebody. When I drive that through my neighborhood, people will say, he's accomplished something, you know? So you have these different cultural and generational, you know, things that unfortunately get in the way of, I mean, there are exceptions, of course, of young people willing to listen to some advice and older people understanding the frustration and disappointments of the young. But I think we can have a whole lot more of that.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, that's where compassion comes in. It's so important for us to have compassion and recognize each of us has our own unique journey of life. We each have our own unique way of experiencing the world. And to not judge, but to be as curious as we possibly can. What does that Cadillac mean to you? Instead of, I have a projection about Cadillac meaning something. What's Cadillac mean to you? Right. And if we can just learn to be curious about each other, to replace judgment with curiosity, right, is one of the great qualities of emotional intelligence.
Yeah, that is absolutely well put. And I'm 100% in agreement with you because, you know, there are times I have to tell you, Scott, there are times when I'm sorely you know, one of the drawbacks for, I don't know if it's a drawback, but one of the side effects of staying informed about a lot of stuff going on in the world is there are moments when I'm tempted to say, is there some way that I can abdicate from the species and, you know, live with the elephants indefinitely? And then every so often, one of the examples of humanity at its best crosses my path. And I am my belief in sticking it out, doing the best I can to be one of the positive factors and learning from those who've preceded me on the path to something, that is the better side of humanity. And what you just finished saying is so true. If we're lucky enough to find a circle of contacts and friends that are of a similar inclination and that enrich our lives by their mere companionship, we are very lucky indeed, and that can sustain us through some of the toughest stuff we go through.
Yeah. Well, there's a good segue to your wildlife advocates work, and I'm pulling up this beautiful photo of you with the monkey. And I love this photo because the way you're looking at it is with so much, what I see, my projection is there's a combination of curiosity and compassion from you both, you know? And the way the monkey's looking at you and the way you're looking at the monkey, it's like this beautiful connection between two different species.
Right.
And it's a really lovely photograph. It grabbed my attention. And so there's the segue. Tell us about your work with wildlife.
Well, that little fellow I'm not sure whether it was a female or male, but you chose something that is a key to the road to, you know, transformation or whatever, because that is a little, as the people of Indonesia and the Dayak, which are the dominant tribe there on Borneo, call it the orang utan, which means person of the forest. And, here I told you earlier about going to, you know, winding up in Toronto, Canada, going to one of the typical schools there. Well, I'm going to jump back and forth a little bit in terms of the timeline, but it came to pass that after getting into wildlife conservation, Jutta gets an email from one of the entities that we had started to support since 2005 and still do to this day, namely the Sheldrick Wildlife Trust in Kenya, which rescues orphan baby elephants, raises them, and then reintroduces them into the wild. And so one of their people says, we have Warner Brothers here, and they're shooting an IMAX film about our baby orphans. And a couple of days later, the producer of the film contacts us and said, I just learned that the film we are making, which is called Born to be Wild, not only features the orphaned elephants, but the other entity that your family foundation has been supporting, we just discovered, namely Orangutan Foundation International. So this film premieres in Los Angeles, and I'm contacted by someone who says, Dr. Baruti Galdikas, who is the third so-called ape angel, the other two being Jane Goodall, chimpanzees, and Diane Fossey, mountain gorillas. This film will be premiered, and Dr. Baruti Galdikas will be here for the premiere. She went to UCLA when Steppenwolf was at the top of the charts. She loves Steppenwolf. She would like to see you guys. Will you play a fundraiser for for short, OFI, Orangutan Foundation International? Okay, fine. So we find out that she's coming to LA, and one of our volunteers says, I'm really plugged in with the media in San Diego, and I can put something together if you're willing to come play this benefit. Okay, fine. I find out that San Diego has a IMAX film, but it's not going to show Born to be Wild for several months to come. So I contact the producer and say, can you twist the arm of Warner Brothers and have them schedule a matinee of showing this, because Dr. Baruta Galdikas will come to be part of our fundraising concert. So he comes back and says, yep, it's a deal. So I go with the band to San Diego, and I go, may I be forgiven in perpetuity, I go on to Fox News, local news, and they're willing to let me pitch this thing. And I'm going, I have a request that all you good people out there who, because the following day, this is a Saturday, is our performance, the next day is Mother's Day. And I say, take your children, take your grandchildren, take your mothers and grandmothers to see a wonderful film about the motherless called Born to be Wild. And so the next day is a matinee only showing, and there are all these children. Not a single one of them is on their little screen. And they watch this film, which is narrated by Morgan Freeman, and which is available for anybody to see on YouTube. And afterwards, Baruti and I, we take questions from the children. Astounding, intelligent, plugged in question, wonderful. Baruti and I get to talk a little more after that, and we discover that her family is Lithuanian in origin. My father's people also were. And she, when the Russians were about to overrun Lithuania, her father took the family to what was still Nazi Germany. And we discover that her family and my stepdad and my mother and I immigrate to Toronto, Canada the same year. And she and I go to the same school at the same time and never meet. And I said, okay, Yuta, we got to go to Borneo. And so we wind up in Borneo with Baruti. And we learned from her about the 300 little orphan orangutans that she looks after, 50 years of research, you know. And we learn that these little ones are orphans because their mothers have been killed so that the poachers can grab the little ones and sell them into the pet trade. And so we immediately wanted to be part of, you know, helping to mitigate that. Yuta's on the board of directors of OFI. And that photo that you saw was me filled with internal rage and deep sorrow. Because once you look into the eyes of this little helpful creature, which is mother dependent for 4 years, and has to learn everything as to how to live up there in the trees, you're not the same after that. I have similar feelings about the orphaned little elephants, but in any case, that was a highly emotional experience. I just admire Baruti tremendously. You know, unlike Jane Goodall and you know, Diane, who had the, of course, was killed by people, but who had the Gorillas in the Mist film. Baruta is on the dark side of the moon. Almost no one knows about, you know, Borneo and the orangutans and all that. So she's been toiling for 50 years to preserve what is still there. And there are so many others that I could mention. But the key moment about Yuta and I wanting to change what moves us in life was when, after having been to Cambodia, initially we wanted to see the amazing temples at Angkor Wat, but we also learned from a young survivor of the killing fields of the Khmer Rouge about the killing fields. And we went out there, learned a lot. And the first thing that our little family foundation did was to build a school, because the fellow who was responsible for this resurgence of school building is a child Holocaust survivor by the name of Bernie Krischer, who I got in contact with, and he said, Prince Sihanouk, later King Sihanouk, said, "Bernie, help us build schools. The Khmer Rouge killed all our teachers. We need schools." And so Bernie started, asking people to help build schools. And that was the first thing that we did. And then we have this amazing experience of a whole village turning out for the opening of the school. And we asked them, because we have the right to name the school whatever we wanted. And we didn't want to make it something that reflected, some people like to honor their parents or whatever. I said, find out from the villagers who they want to honor. And I got this wonderful email from someone who speaks eloquent English without speaking English. And it said, the community has decided that a school should be named after Titmom, who was a midwife who lost her husband to the Khmer Rouge. And in spite of that, during the war, kept bringing young babies into the world, never charged a dime because the people were poor. And our village said that when Titmom died, she left nothing behind, quote, except the good she had done, engraved in the hearts of the people. And so that kicked off our little foundation. And that same year, we had our first experience with wildlife in East Africa. And there was a particular moment when we came across a little pyramid with a plaque that said, Michael Grismick, he gave all he possessed, including his life, for the wild animals of Africa. And that launched a train of thought with me that I'm still on to this day, because I talked to Yuna and I said, we've seen this beautiful, area with these magnificent creatures. And what are we gonna do to help preserve the treasures that we have seen? And that then caused, by the time we were done doing all these things, there was about 17 different NGOs and people who, unlike some of us who were spellbound by the spotlight, have been guardians of wildlife who've inspired us. It's a very humbling thing to see how someone is willing to dedicate their life to something like this. And that's, the path we are still on.
Well, that leads to, I'm pulling up on the website, this foundation that you just briefly mentioned, but I want to really acknowledge the MAUEKAY Foundation. And people can go there by going to MAUEKAY. MAUEKAY, that's Yuta's last name and your last name, .org. Tell us, John, a little bit about the foundation and what you have accomplished and what you are still working on and want to accomplish.
Yeah, thank you for that. That's enormously helpful. It was one of those things we started off with, first the baby elephants, who are just, magnificent, wonderful creatures. I could, there's some video clips on the very website that you showed, just for the sake of enjoyment, even if people don't necessarily want to contribute, they can enjoy these videos because it puts them together with these little creatures and how astounding they are. It was really these two things at the beginning, the orangutans and the elephants. But each time we went to East Africa, we would come across yet another wonderful organization or NGO or person who was struggling to protect what remains of our wild creatures. And so bit by bit, the number of NGOs kept increasing. And then I was going, well, wait a minute, you know, we want to support some of these newly discovered entities. And so in 2007 marked the 40th anniversary of Steppenwolf. And I said, listen, guys, 40 years is long enough. Let's make it a farewell tour. Okay, so that's that. The next year, 2008, we had the entire year, Jutta and I, free to do as we pleased. And so we went mountain gorilla tracking. We did all sorts of things. And the more we did that, the more we learned from others who were doing things we wanted to support. And so it occurred to me, well, Steppenwolf is no longer performing and we need to keep feeding the beast, as it were. So I got a hold of our bandmates and our crew, which had at that point been together, you know, our crew almost 30 years. And I said, would you guys be willing to do something different? I have this idea. I want to do like maybe a dozen, 15 really high paying shows a year. And then that way Jutta and I can use the net proceeds of what we do to keep the foundation funded. And that's what we did for the following 10 years, resuming in 2009, and then finally throwing in the towel in October 2018. Well, I thought, well, I may as well go on the road as a solo performer. But then, of course, the COVID crisis, put all of my calendared dates on hold. And so I thought, well, this presentation that you showed a video of at the beginning of our conversation today, I will invite people to, $10 here, $10 there, whatever you want to do, help us sustain the support of, you know, the over 1,000 rangers who have lost their lives by poachers who have killed them while trying to protect our living creatures and all the other ones. So, you know, we keep kind of nudging people to say, don't feel that a few bucks here and there don't make a difference. As Edmund Burke said eons ago, nobody ever made a greater mistake than he who let me see if I remember. Then he who did nothing because he thought he could only do a little. You know, so $5 to buy a mosquito net for a child that doesn't get, malaria or whatever, it all matters. And, so we keep chipping away at funding. We had a marvelous guy who left Australia. He is in the armed forces Afghanistan and in Iraq, and he took all of his training into Zimbabwe. He has an amazing film that's on Netflix called Akashinga, The Brave Ones. It's all about these women, man, these women that he taught, hand-to-hand combat and, people who are the guardians of wildlife that are continuing to work to try to keep, our living treasures from leaving leaving. Sometimes, there is just a a thing where, you know, it's a natural thing for human beings to look after their own. You know, I mean, we look after our own children, and that's natural, I think. You know, first comes all the stuff that are that we want to that we consider as being dear to us. But by the same token, I think it's important for us not to remember our fellow creatures that are in great ways of winding up. Ever so many of them are disappearing almost every day, and so there are so many who work to see to it that our fellow creatures don't leave this this great place that we call home. You know, it's something that we do as well as we are able to, and we ask those people who are I'm really astounded. So you have to kind of give me a moment, because I have somehow managed to actually find certain words that at times, you know, have caused me to learn my way of putting certain words together, and it's something that has really kind of it has left me in a way that has caused me to kind of, I think I need to take a moment while you give me a give me a new
I'll come in for a moment, because there's so many things you said that are really beautiful, John. And I think what I'm hearing is how important it is for us as human beings to remember that ideally we are caretakers of this world and not rapists of this world. And that humankind at its worst takes, and humankind at its best gives. And I think that's part of our, something that we learn individually. Right. We learn the joy of giving. My mentor was Dr. Marshall Rosenberg, and probably my favorite quote from Marshall was that the greatest joy in life is contributing to the well-being of others. The greatest tragedy in life is not having learned that. And it's true that some people haven't experienced within themselves the joy of giving, how beautiful it feels to give. And those are the people that on the one hand are sociopaths and create a lot of pain, but they're also tragic characters because they haven't even learned how wonderful it feels to contribute to another. And those people that are still lost in the give me, give me, give me, of course, it's a black hole, right? It's, you can never get enough. You can never get enough. But we can always give, and it feels so good to give. And I think that that's a big part of our growth as human beings individually. And it's a big part of, hopefully, our evolution as a species. Because clearly what we're seeing, the difference between a tyrannical regime, as your mother had to escape from, and as we still see as a possibility, On the microcosm, really learning how to take care of. And so I'm being reminded that we're at 11:30, so I have to wrap us up. But I want to go back one more time to your foundation and the beauty of the life journey of John and MAUEKAY, married for 51 years from incredibly humble beginnings to tremendous rock star success, and then maturing, choosing to mature and to evolve into creating this beautiful foundation that is supporting wildlife. And I want to encourage, I'm certainly going to donate today. So when you go to the MAUEKAY.org, that's spelled MAUEKAY.org, and then right here in the upper right-hand corner, please donate. And there's a lot of ways to donate. And you can donate and watch the film, which is great. And I noticed Jay Mayer said, hey, I want to watch the rest of the movie. So this is the way to do it. Go to their foundation, click, and that's how you can watch the rest of the movie. We showed you, I think, the first 15 minutes or so. And I have watched the film, and it's beautiful. It's powerful. But let's all donate, everybody. Let's do that. And I'm going to click, I'm going to put the link into our Facebook post, and I'll also, of course, put it in the chat box right now. And John, I so have enjoyed. I would just love to spend hours more talking with you, because you have a wisdom and a sincerity and a humility that is really cool, coming from somebody that was certainly somebody that I was enamored with as a teenager and growing up, and that I learned from. You know, your album Monster was really a waking up point for me about, oh my God, my country isn't necessarily the good guys. Oh my God, you know, we've become a monster. And that album, that song was a painful part of my awakening. As we talked about earlier, the way that you expressed your anger about the pusher. And, you know, so thank you for how you influenced me when I was young, and thank you for how you're influencing me today.
Well, thank you. Because having an opportunity today, you know, I want to thank you for letting me be a guest in this. And it was very, I have to confess that I was really kind of surprised how I really kind of, you know, let you hear certain things that for me was really quite a kind of a situation. I was not prepared to do. It just kind of came out of left field. But I'm glad I did, because, you know, instead of just doing the regular stuff that one does often with interviews and so on, this was for me also quite meaningful.
Yeah, John, it was beautiful for us. And thank you for opening your heart and sharing on a deeper level, because that's what we're all going to take away from it. And it's a chance to see your beautiful, precious humanity, you know, and what an incredible journey of life you've had. And I'm looking forward to watching how the next 77 years go.
Yeah, and I also want to quickly thank Jan, because you asked a question that really enabled me. You know, I had not done that with anyone, to kind of really dig a little deeper in terms of my wife. My mother, who was really a role model for me in the sense of not letting life beat you down when certain things come at you. And, you know, so thank you for that, Jan.
You're welcome. And, you know, we also need to thank our mutual friend, Joanne Shenandoah, who introduced us, and who's a really dear person. And so anyways, much gratitude to you, John, and your wife.
Thank you.
And John, we're definitely going to want to ask you to come back on future shows. It's been really wonderful chatting with you. And hopefully next time we'll get a chance to meet Yuta. That would be really wonderful.
Right.
I want to thank everybody for watching. And you know, please donate. Go to John's Foundation, and also share this out. And to all of you watching the replay, go ahead and you can still pop in comments. I always go back and I take a look at what comments come in. And I know that a lot of you will be watching this on the replay. Share it out with your friends and let's all support John's organization. John, have a beautiful sacred Sunday. And remember, everybody, we can make any day, any moment sacred just by choosing to be in gratitude, like we started with our meditation. Practicing the attitude of gratitude makes any moment sacred. Thank you very much, and have a beautiful, beautiful day. God's blessings.